right, guys, it is WrestleMania time, and today Michael Gross and Ashley join me for part one of the two-part WrestleMania review, and this is a long show. This really may be the longest show that we've ever done in almost 2.5 hours of the part one review, so take a listen before you watch part two of WrestleMania to get yourself all geared up and ready for the show. So we discussed everything that you can think of with WrestleMania, the good, the bad, the ugly, and everything in between. So strap in, and we'll be right back after this.
If you miss sports right now as much as I do, make sure you check out the 3OT Triple Overtime podcast on Apple Podcasts or Spotify today. These guys find a way to discuss and dissect sports, especially during a time where we really could use some. Check out the latest episode where they interview NFL draft prospect and running back from the University of South Carolina, Caleb Kinlaw. Find out how he's preparing for the draft and how football continues to move forward despite the current coronavirus pandemic that seems to have taken over sports as we know it. Listen to the latest episode today on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Overcast, or anywhere you listen to podcasts. Also, be sure to check them out on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter at 3OT Podcast. Again, that's the 3OT Triple Overtime Podcast. Check them out today.
Welcome to the WWE Podcast, the most passionate and authentic wrestling analysis on the web. We've got you covered with every Raw, SmackDown, and NXT show, giving you a no bullshit opinion. We know you love wrestling. We do too. So let's get this show underway.
And that's the bottom line. What? Cause Stone Cold said so.
All right, guys, welcome to the WWE Podcast on this post-WrestleMania Part 1 review. As I record this, it is midday on Sunday, so Part 2 of WrestleMania comes to us tonight, and I know that I'm excited for it. Overall, I liked the two-hour format, or the two-night format. I think many people did as well. Very controversial AJ Styles Undertaker format, and we discussed that match with Michael and Ashley and obviously myself as we went through every match and every angle of the match, what we're looking forward to tonight. And, you know, as WWE moves forward with this weird format of empty arenas, you know, how do they move forward with what the decisions that they've made, and Braun Strowman is Universal Champion and all of that. And, you know, what does WWE do? And maybe the outcomes would have been different if the WWE didn't have this pandemic going on and it was in front of a live audience. So there's a lot to discuss, and I'm not going to give you my normal long intro of what we're going to be doing. You guys know it's tomorrow is going to be part two of WrestleMania review with Mary and with Zach as we discuss the WrestleMania card in its entirety, part two. And then it'll be Raw review, and then it's nostalgia, and then it's into NXT and AEW. So there's going to be a lot of shows, a lot of content, audio for you guys this week. But it is a jam-packed week, and I'm looking forward to being able to share it with you guys and give you reviews for everything that happens. So hope you guys are ready, because this is a long, long show. So maybe digest it in separate parts or as you can, as we're all sitting quarantined in our homes. So just listen to it, enjoy it, and any feedback at the WWE Podcast. And by the way, you want your WrestleMania thoughts or questions? Email me an audio file, just a voice memo on your phone. Email it to realwwepodcast@gmail.com, and I'll get it in the show and answer it in real time, and that'll be a blast. So I'll be tweeting throughout the show tonight, and be fun to interact with you guys as we get the conclusion of WrestleMania with Randy and Edge and John Cena and Bray Wyatt and so on, and Brock and Drew. So this is going to be a fun night. It's going to be a fun time. Thank you guys for listening. Let's just jump into it and enjoy it, and I'll talk to you soon. WrestleMania Part 1 is in the books, and today I've got two co-hosts. You guys know them. You love them. Michael Gross and Ashley Mann are with me today as we are, for the first time ever, recording in the morning after the Part 1 pay-per-view of WrestleMania. So guys, welcome to the show, and Michael, I'll speak with you first. I gotta ask, overall, what do you think of the two-night format? Not getting into any specifics about what happened last night, And Ashley, I'll ask you the same question. But Michael, I got to ask, do you like this two-night format so far? I know we haven't seen part two yet, but is it cool to you that we now have a second night of WrestleMania?
You know, at first I thought I was going to have a problem with it, but I really don't. New Japan has already discovered and tried and gone down this route. So I like the fact that I wasn't exhausted. I wasn't waiting to take a bathroom break. I like the fact that, you know, it wasn't 3 hours of pre-show building up. So, yeah, I like it. I like it.
Ashley?
Yeah, I agree. I was not sure how I was going to like it going into it. But I think so far so good. And being someone who was at WrestleMania last year, I can tell you I personally would have been more energized and more pumped for the last three matches on last year's 8-hour show, what it felt like. Just because you got to think about the fans in attendance, right? So, for instance, last year, the first ever women's main event, I feel like the crowd would have been much more involved and engaged. And the second Becky Lynch won and the second a three count came down, we all had to scurry out because of transportation issues. So just little things like that, I feel like, would make a huge difference going forward. And I think this may be one of the takeaways that WWE can take out of this whole bizarre situation that maybe they can look into going forward. I'm not sure if they'd be able to make an adjustment for next year's WrestleMania, just because I'm not sure how it goes about renting the stadium for an additional night and things of that nature. But yeah, if they could start maybe not next year or the year after a two-night format, I'd be here for it.
So
I'm sorry, really quick. I'm a big fan of pay-per-views on Saturday nights. Common knowledge, but why is pay-per-views on Sunday nights? Why wouldn't you do a Saturday night type of deal for all sports, even like, you know, for like the Super Bowl and stuff like that? Why is everything designed on Sundays? Because families are normally home, quote unquote, on Sunday nights.
The only reason I can think of beyond, well, that's the way we've always done it, which is not a good reason, is right. That most people, even if they have a work Monday through Friday, sometimes people work Saturday. Most people are home Sundays, and so Sunday is statistically the day that in which people work the least, so they're home more, which means you have higher ratings. So outside of that, I don't know. Michael, you have any idea why pay-per-views traditionally fall on Sunday? I mean, I can't think of any other reason other than people's work schedules.
I think it all comes back to the Super Bowl, the biggest event of the year. The most eyeballs on television were always on a Sunday night, and that's always been typically the day, like you said, everybody's home. That's why you always have that phrase, the go home episode, because Sunday everybody is home, and it's, you know, post church crowd in the morning, post evening church crowd. It's supposed to be, well, we have nothing to do, it's Sunday, tomorrow's work, give me something great before I go back to work. I think that's kind of the mindset behind it. It's always been like that as far as I've been watching, but I think that's what it is.
Yeah, but it probably is, absolutely. And I wish that they would go to Saturdays. And so I guess my opinion on this two-night format is I'm really liking this, that, you know, now we have a lot of good matches left. And it seems as if the way that they split it, that the second half of WrestleMania is a little bit more stacked than the first. Mm-hmm. You've got John Cena and The Fiend. You've got the WWE Championship match. I mean, you've got a lot of big matches tonight that I'm like, oh man, they're waiting until tomorrow night. I wish, you know, I want to see that match. When they started talking about the matches, I'm like, oh, that's tomorrow night. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't seem as if they went 50-50 in terms of star power. And if I was them, I probably would have made the bigger matches and the bigger stars on the second night. So overall, I'm liking this two-hour format. As you said, Ashley, I am all for if they ever want to in the future decide to split this into two nights or just do it all on Saturday night. If they're going to have the marathon show, do it on Saturday night so that people don't have to take off work. It's easier logistically for people to go on a Saturday for most people. But I just, as you said, the problem is there's a lot of things that go with that. Because it's not as simple as, oh, we'll split it into two nights. Like you said, renting buildings. People then have to stay two nights in a hotel versus one night maybe for some people. So there's a lot of things and extra expenses that maybe people aren't thinking about when it comes to the two-night format. Although the millions of people watching at home, I think, would love it more. And it's a very nice length of time. 3 hours is the perfect, it's the sweet spot for a pay-per-view. It's like watching Monday Night Raw, except you're in a pay-per-view mode, so you're okay with it being longer. And when you look back, WrestleMania 15 was under 3 hours. Like, it's insane. Like, when you look back at some of the pay-per-views that were actually under 3 hours. So, I don't know. I love this. It's like two pay-per-views that you're getting on two different nights at a reasonable amount of time. So, I don't know. I'm loving the format.
Yeah, and really quick before we move on, it kind of made me even more pumped for tonight, right? So, like, you kind of, especially for our unique situation, like, everyone was kind of leery, and as we spoke as well, we were kind of like, what is this going to look like? Is it going to, you know, crap the bed? You know, what is it going to be like? And I think going into it night one, you got a feel for it. It was kind of like a nice feel for both, right? You got a feel for a normal match, a stipulations match, and a match completely outside of the arena, which is exactly what we're going to have tonight. We're going to have a falls count or a last man standing match, which is essentially a falls count anywhere type-ish match. You're going to have your normal matches in the ring, and then you're going to have your Firefly Funhouse. So I'm just very excited for tonight's show, and last night splitting it up actually got me more invested in tonight's show. And like you said, like when I realized that John Cena and Bray Wyatt weren't on last night, I was like, oh, bummer, man. I was really looking forward to it. But, you know, just got to wait for tonight now. So I'm very positive coming out of night one in that respect.
I won't fall asleep watching it. So that's me right there. You know, like I said, I'm in my 40s. Sometimes I doze off. But, yeah, I'm really amped to see what's going to happen tonight. With that being said, though, I'm ready to dive into what happened last night. Our team with some stuff.
Yeah, let's do it, because I got to start with probably what left us scratching our heads. Some people loved it, some people hated it, and overall, I will say I ran a poll on Twitter, of which I have a few hundred votes, and I asked people. I said, "What did you think of last night's WrestleMania?" And I basically asked them to grade it. You know, how would you grade it? Did you love it? Was it mostly good? Not sure. Or what the hell did I just see? And 70% of people either loved it or felt it was mostly good. So, I mean, whether that's a sample size that is representative of the whole, maybe, maybe not. But, you know, as far as the specifics go, I do want to jump into the Undertaker-AJ Styles match. I have to jump into this. And I will save my opinion for the last opinion, because I want to hear what you guys think about it. And I know, Michael, you are very you and I were texting a little bit last night, and you were very down on it. And I absolutely understand why. I was too, to a point. And then, I you know, some realizations came to me about the alternatives of that match, of what could have been. So without giving my opinion, Michael, I'll ask you first, because I know you and I were texting. So what did you think about this? After now you've had a night to digest it and think about it, do you still feel the same way you did last night?
I'm not going to change my opinion, but I'm going to explain why I feel the way I did. First of all, for anybody who, you know, a few years ago watched the whole, you know, broken Matt Hardy thing and Impact and all that and thought that was hokey, last night wasn't as hokey, but it was out there. You had the Druids coming out of the barn wall. We don't know the location of this supposed graveyard. There was a soundtrack. And then, you know, the whole Undertaker repeating that he's going to beat AJ Styles with a shovel, but there was no spade or head on the shovel. It was just a stick. But what was that all about? And the other thing that bothered me was, if you're going to see these two guys do it one time in their life, you squash the guy twice going up to this. Did it have to be a complete glorified squash for the match? You could have given us more, especially with Anderson and Gallows there. You could have given us so much more, more competitive. The big thing about The Undertaker wrestling at WrestleMania is you want to have that belief that he might lose, and you never – ever once saw that in this match. It was just squash. Oh, a little bit of it, offense thanks to a weapon. Squash. Let's go on a roof for no good reason. Let's throw people off the roof for no good reason, which is attempted murder. Whatever, it's wrestling. We have to suspend some, you know, belief, whatever. But at the end of days, I was not a fan, especially the fact that, you know, when he rides off at the end, a score of music hits one more time, and I'm going, this is one of the most convoluted things I've ever seen in my life. The last time I saw WWE try to pull something off like this was when Jake the Snake buried the Undertaker up to his neck, and then the camera was from the Ultimate Warrior's eyes. It was the Ultimate Warrior, not the Undertaker. From his eyes, you could see his point of view. I'm like, why am I seeing out of the Warrior's eyes? And that was like the same thing I kind of felt with this match. Thoughts?
Ashley?
Okay. I definitely agree with certain things that you mentioned about sometimes it got a little too hokey and, you know, just out of the box. I guess I'll start with my little nitpicks from it. Certain things like you mentioned at the end when he was about to write off, like his symbol being, you know, at the top of the like farmhouse, whatever building that was. And then little things like that. And when the druids came out and the lights shone and everything like that. So I get it. You know, I totally get what you're saying. Little things like that are like, you know, come on. And I guess what would maybe help with what you're saying is with the whole where were they type thing, even if we don't know exactly where they were location wise, but if it was made to seem like this was Undertaker's backyard type thing, like if this was like, you know, because now we kind of have this hybrid version of the Undertaker, right? Like it's not necessarily the Dead Man or the American Badass or just Mark Calloway or Galloway, depending on the day. It's like some weird hybrid of all three. So we didn't need like a full, in my opinion, we didn't need a full like, oh, they're in Texas or they're in this exact place, but maybe just have something to show us that this is Undertaker's place and maybe have AJ show up with the OC. But because the way it all played out was, I get what you're saying, like he wrote up and everything was just kind of like they just kind of met at this random place. And so you would naturally think since AJ was there first that maybe AJ would have an advantage. But so like, I definitely get what you're saying there. Overall, though, I dug it. I was a fan of the Ultimate Deletion and all that nonsense. It was, in my opinion, it wasn't as campy as that. But again, like you said, you know, the soundtrack and things like that is totally not realistic. But in a sense, like this whole thing wasn't realistic. So I'm kind of giving them a pass on all that. And of course, like at the end where AJ's hand sticks up, I think, I don't know if you guys saw it, but the best visual from that meme of AJ's hand sticking out was Montez Ford sticking the red solo cup on AJ's hand. It was, that just like was the icing on top for me. So overall, I really enjoyed it. And I think this is a good way to prolong Undertaker, whatever name he's going to go by. I'm just going to call him Undertaker for now. I think if they can figure out a way to do a format like this in the future for him, they could get, I'm scared to even say it, a couple more years, 3-4 more years out of him. I'm not saying it's the best idea in the world, but if they're dead set on keeping him around, this is the best way to do it.
Dead set, no pun intended, yes. So you guys bring up points, and I feel like this is a match you either loved or you really, really didn't, depending on what your view or what your expectation was of this match. And when I was, after the match was over, I initially went, what the hell was that? I said, you know, my belief is not even, I can't even suspend my belief no matter how hard I try. The way that they presented it, I said, it was. I think the worst part of it was the soundboard, was the actual punching sounds they post-produced into the match. With almost every punch, they actually put that in like we were watching a movie. And I don't know if they were doing that on the sly to make it sound better, or if they did it knowing that this is a presentation like a movie and that they're going to be okay with people knowing that they put the punch sounds in post-production. And, you know, when I look at the alternative, though, and I say what this match could have been if they went with this and it was in Tampa with no coronavirus and the match went on as scheduled, which it would have been in ring. I don't think they would have done a boneyard match, a.k.a. a buried alive / graveyard match, that they probably wouldn't have put on. I don't know if it would have been this well received as it was last night. And many people, unbelievably, do absolutely love this match. They loved it. And I see why. It was a very... It was like a horror movie, and I don't know, Michael, you might have told me this. It was kind of like a bad horror movie production, but it had moments. It had really cool moments. I mean, the scenery was cool. I did enjoy that. It was very spooky. It was in a setting that I thought it would be. I'm a big fan of making sure camera angles make sense. And the camera angles where they just happen to be there perfectly at a time where there never would be a camera there, with like Undertaker riding in on his motorcycle, like basically like a drone view of him coming in. But if you accept the presentation that they were trying to give us, that this is basically a movie style presentation. This is not your normal in-ring presentation. Then I think you may enjoy this more than if you want to see this in a believable in-ring mano-a-mano true competition. And if you take that away and you just accept it for movie style, then this wasn't too bad. I'm actually coming away with this a little bit less negative than I was last night. The hand sticking up, I mean, really, I mean, that is the most cliched thing that you can do in a horror movie. And I didn't hear how they win this match. They just challenged Taker to this match, but we never got a, hey, here's how you win. Is it just last man standing, or you know, until someone dies? I mean, there was no here's how you win. But with Undertaker there to bury AJ, that was really the only way you could win the match. It was a buried alive match. But with everything going on, as I said to both of you, they're not going to do a graveyard. You can't mention graveyard. You can't mention buried alive, given the sensitivity of things going on. But that's essentially what it was. It was a graveyard buried alive match. The special effects were cool. Again, if you accept that this is a presentation of a movie match rather than an actual wrestling match, the choke slams on the roof. I mean, again, with that perspective and lens, I'm fine with it. It just takes me a while to take away that normal pro wrestling mentality of what I like to see in a match. If I remove that from my brain, I actually like this. So it was so different than anything we've ever seen, that as long as you look at it from that lens, I think you might enjoy it. But again, it comes down to, can you remove that pro wrestling presentation that you like and that we all love about wrestling and remove it and just enjoy it for the movie style? So.
Yeah, and really quick, what did you guys think of this new version of The Undertaker? Do you want this going forward, or do you want the Dead Man back?
No, I actually love the American Badass version of him so much better. I was never a huge fan of the Dead Man. A lot of people tell me it's blasphemy, but as a person who's been watching wrestling as long as I have, I was never a fan of somebody over gimmicking. And The Undertaker himself stated that that was his favorite persona because he showed that he could sell. He had more to give his opponents. He felt that the whole Dead Man thing, it's really humbling of him for what he has said, that he felt he could never give his opponents anything in the ring. And that always made it look like he had bad matches up until you got into that weird corporate ministry Cenobite version where he was selling a little bit more. But then when you got to the American Badass and he was humanized, I really like that. I love this new version because it's a blend of both. You're going back to the, you know, crazy motorcycle redneck. I'm fine with it. Go with it.
Yeah, I'm with you. I think, and really what the test is going to be is, if the true character change is indeed true, how do they present it the next time he comes out in an actual arena? You know, because you can do something like this in a graveyard where he's coming out on the bike, but how do they present it the next time that he's in, you know, I mean, St. Louis or Cleveland or wherever? How does he come out? Is it just go back to the Dead Man and pretend that this never happened? Does he come back out on the bike and he's kind of a 2020 version of the American Badass? I don't know the answer.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking about as well. And my guess would be they just forget all this happened and go straight back to the Dead Man version. But yeah, like you were mentioning, Michael, I agree with that because if he, especially being the Dead Man, he doesn't have the range and the availability to really cut like a decent and normal promo. Dead Man Talk is just like, you know, like he's going to steal your soul, you're going to rest in peace and all that. But in it, it's kind of like cut and paste and just like insert new opponent's name here. Granted, like he, no one could ever cut a promo in that manner like he could. So he's definitely, you know, that character is definitely respected. But yeah, he this version or the American Badass version of him just does allow him so much more range. And like he has said before, like, it would allow him to go out and do more meet and greets and stuff like that, too. Like, because you can't be the dead man out in public, right? It's just kind of, like, awkward. But, yeah, I would like for them to continue with this character going forward, but I don't see it, not with the climate that it is right now. And how would you really continue it going on? Like, who would his next opponent even be, you know? It's just kind of weird now. Like, okay, like, where he's no longer the dead man. He's this new version of himself, but, like, what do you do next? Not that it's that big of a deal, because it's not like he's on weekly or anything, but I'm just curious to see what they do with him filing up after this.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry, Matt. I was just going to say it's going to be a year for them to build it up. I've already got one opponent in mind, and they've got all the tools to make it happen, but they're both way past their prime. But honestly, with the center down there, with everything and the ability to, you know, stay healthy over the year, the one match that they never had, now that they had Sting, Abyss.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, and I think we got a big clue, and I don't know if you guys saw this or not. I'm sure you did. The whole show that WWE is producing, it's called The Last Ride with The Undertaker, and he's, you know.
Oh, yeah.
That tells me that they're preparing for his true retirement. I mean, you wouldn't mm-hmm. call a show The Last Ride if this year it wasn't going to truly be the last ride. At least that's my thinking. And this year will officially mark the 30th year of The Undertaker's debut at Survivor Series. And I know that I've talked about this before, but I think we got a huge hint this past summer with the Firefly Funhouse when Stone Cold was going to be on Raw. And his Bray Wyatt was in his Firefly Funhouse, and his clock said 3:16. He hit it with a hammer, and it said November 17th. I think that was the day that The Undertaker debuted. And nothing ever came of that. But it had November, again, I think it was November 17th on his clock, and it just kind of was left there. And so could The Undertaker retire at Survivor Series, or could he retire truly at next year's WrestleMania? The point is, I think it's going to be...
Or that could be the start for his retirement tour like they
exactly,
did with Rick.
Exactly. Yeah. And if you don't think Undertaker's going to be at this year's Survivor Series, I mean, that would be the biggest miss of an opportunity in the world. I mean, I think it is going to happen. It could very well be Bray Wyatt. Undertaker could be... in a feud with somebody else, and we have the Fiend attack and interrupt the Undertaker maybe at the end of his match. Some way, somehow, I really truly believe it's going to be the Fiend that ends up retiring the Undertaker.
That would be perfect.
It'd be a great way to reestablish him. Great way to reestablish him, because it's not that he's bad now, but, you know, after that whole Goldberg thing that, you know, left a little sour taste in my mouth, I just want to see him on another strong push.
And there's nothing – I mean, how much bigger could it get than retiring The Undertaker? And if you just have three men that have beaten The Undertaker at WrestleMania, which is obviously Goldberg – or I'm sorry, Roman Reigns, Brock Lesnar, and then The Fiend, who's actually the one to end it, that's how you build the next generation of stars. And Undertaker would be the first man to tell you that he's about giving back to the business. And there's no better way than putting over Bray Wyatt to retire him in his final match. So anyway, we're getting like 6 months ahead of ourselves here, but – so overall, guys, I mean, any final thoughts on the AJ Styles Undertaker graveyard, boneyard, buried alive match?
If I could take the reins for a second, I just think that, like I said, I wasn't a big fan of the whole cameras where cameras shouldn't be kind of thing, and especially the whole shovel with no head on it. It maybe my eyes, but. Did you guys see that too? You know,
yeah,
he was just.
I saw it. I chuckled when he kept saying shovel and there was no head on it.
Yeah, I saw that.
Kevin Dunn has always been one of the highest paid guys for WWE, and I think he just could have cleaned this up a little bit sharper. We could have done without the music. We could have done definitely without the sound of celery slapping. You know, when they punched each other. I was actually looking to see if they were slapping their leg when we were texting each other. I'm like, what is going on with these punches? This is so silly. But I think if it was a bit more, what's the word? Just a bit more of a contest, and it actually looked like AJ was in danger of hurting The Undertaker or beating him. We could have sank our teeth into it, especially with the fact that he was buried twice before this. It's The Undertaker's day. I get it. I don't ever think that streak should have been defeated until his retirement, but you have to have that believability that someone's going to beat you, and it just did not look like that. That's my closing thoughts on that.
Yeah, I'll just wrap up and say I did enjoy it. Again, there's some things that I would have probably tweaked and done without myself, but in totality, I was pleased with it. I thought Undertaker looked like a badass coming out of it. I'm slightly concerned for AJ, but I think if anyone were to face Undertaker in this type of situation and bounce back with just one promo and kind of make us forget about it, it'll be AJ. I probably wouldn't have had him look so weak in towards the Undertaker in the weeks building up to it, but you know, it's WWE. Sometimes, you know, they just barely go week by week. But yeah, I enjoyed it, and I'm looking forward to how the Firefly Funhouse plays out, because I'm sure it's just going to be just as obnoxious and out of pocket as this was. So on to night two.
Exactly. That's what I'm wondering is how, I'm assuming it's a similar presentation in that it's very movie-esque. And yeah, this is right up Kevin Dunn and really Vince McMahon's alley, because they have been running from what they truly are, a pro wrestling company, for many, many years now. They'll tell you they're not pro wrestling. They'll tell you, oh, we're sports entertainment. Sports entertainment, when you break it down, isn't really a thing. Sports is entertaining by its nature. So sports entertainment's not a genre. Like, I don't even want to get into that. But I really think that the Firefly Funhouse is probably going to be a very similar presentation, and it's right up their alley to really show people what they're in their minds they would like to show wrestling as kind of this movie. If they could do this on a weekly basis for every match, I really believe that they would love to do it. Just because that's what this is, wrestling, or this is sports entertainment, guys. Wrestling's in the ring. I mean, that's Kevin.
It's everything they love in one package.
Exactly. It's their fantasy land right now. They get to finally do what they want to do to show us what their presentation of wrestling is. And that's why it's such a controversial type of presentation. But I expect something very similar for the Firefly Funhouse, obviously in a much different setting. I would assume that it's probably going to be something that is in some kind of funhouse, like you'd see at a fair of sorts, with, like, you know, those mirrors and, you know, clowns.
Those fairs that you, like, don't really want to touch anything. You know, it's like, yes, you don't want to buy any food from. You feel kind of gross going to, and, like, you know, it's like, where do these people, like, is this like an actual fair, or did you just guys like find this equipment somewhere and just like go town to town type thing? Like the most rundown fair you can imagine. That's
exactly
how I envision it.
Yes, with creepy clowns. Yes, yes.
Yeah, and just like disgusting looking people. Just yeah, just like the worst. Like, did you ever see the movie The Hills Have Eyes? Like those,
yes,
type of people. Like just like grungy. Like, where did these people come from? Are you even a human being type? Like, that's just how I envision it.
like Bubba's cousin Jessica, that might be inbred, is like running the fair wheel. No one knows.
Right.
License to do it, or how his woggly eye seems to stay straight when they, you know, let people in and off. Yeah, I gotcha. Dirt.
Yeah,
fair.
Yeah. It's like, this is my wife, but she's also my cousin. Yeah.
That's true. Yeah, that's exactly. No. I think we're probably hitting it on the head.
We are.
It's because you know it's going to be way over the top, and that's exactly what this should be, and that's fine. I think I will go into this one now, seeing what they did with Taker and AJ, going, okay, now I see the presentation they're going for. It's very movie-esque. There's going to be a lot of special effects, cameras where they shouldn't be. It's like a movie. So I think I'll accept it a little bit better this time around, knowing what they have in mind. So maybe we can get a little bit of a preview at the end of this. So I want to get to the next match here, which, again, I think people are very split on this. But, Ashley, I'll start with you. Braun Strowman winning the Universal Championship in Roman Reigns' place, who we all probably know that Roman would have won had he actually decided to compete, but he didn't. We all, I think, agree with his decision not to. What are your thoughts on the match itself, how it was laid out, and Braun Strowman winning the Universal Championship?
It's like, where do I start? This one is the one that I had an uneasy feeling about the second it ended. And I don't, I guess I do know why, but I don't know which one is, like, making me feel this way the most. So, In my eyes, Braun is a transitional champion. He is just holding it. And I hate to say it, because if we were talking 2 years ago, Braun Strowman, like, I would have been all for it. I just, had they been, and of course, I guess I should say this first, like, no one had any idea this was going to happen, right? That said, if you're going to put a title on someone, I just, if you just look at Braun Strowman for the past 6 months, like, he wasn't built up as even, like, an Intercontinental-worthy champion, and then he won that, which is fine. And then just to be put into this situation at the last second and become the champion, I don't know. The match itself played out exactly how I thought it was going to, regardless if it was Braun or Roman in that situation. You hit a few spears on one side, few spears on the next, whatever, or hit your strong moves. So I guess in that sense, the match itself was fine. But the decision to put it on Braun, like, again, in my mind, this is, he's just holding it until Roman is able to come back and everything is kind of back to normal, or whatever standards it needs to be for Roman to be able to come back and work on a weekly basis. But, man, I don't know. It's one of those things, and I think what first hit me the wrong way with this match was, okay, so Braun Strowman can kick out of a spear, but the Fiend can't. Braun Strowman can take, what was it, like, four spears and kick out and go on to win the match, but the Fiend, who was being built up as this indestructible monster, just this crazy thing, loses by one spear and a suplex. So I think for me, and again, hindsight is 2020, and it's nothing that they could have done last night or whenever they recorded this match to go back and fix how the Fiend's match played out, but it's just, for me, one of those things, it's like, and again, I get what they were doing with the Fiend, big picture, but I just, man, it kind of took the, whatever enjoyment I could have manifested for Braun Strowman winning last night, like, it just kind of took that steam away from it for me personally, because it's just like, yeah, you know, like, I don't want to say they ruined the Fiend because it didn't ruin him, but they severely impacted his character and did all these things to make sure it was Roman and Goldberg, which, again, fine, it couldn't be Roman and Goldberg. It's not really that big of a deal, but to get to a match to have Goldberg being the champion and then it's just Braun, like, I don't know, like, even if you didn't have an idea with Goldberg outside of this, like, at least just make up some type of deal to, like, even if it's just, like, a one-match thing, like, you don't do anything with him, he doesn't show up where he Skypes in, you know, every week, and so Roman can come back, and then he has that match with Roman, Roman wins, and that's it. Yeah, sorry, that was a long-winded answer. This was just the one that really rubbed me the wrong way last night. Obviously.
Michael, do you agree?
I agree for a lot of reasons. You know my restaurant analogies because you know my background, what I do. Basically, what I saw last night is that someone just tried to serve me a New York strip and tell me that it was prime rib. It doesn't make sense. We put a belt on Goldberg because the whole thing was to elevate Roman Reigns. Roman Reigns can't make it, and God bless him because I know it's a messed up situation. I feel for him. And honestly, I think he did the right thing, but I'm not going to get into that right now. When people say, well, the natural person to replace him is Braun Strowman, well, how? He didn't earn anything. And like Ashley said, he was looking like an intercontinental chump. And it's difficult for, especially when you're in a bracket where the title doesn't mean anything anymore, and you can't even hold on to that, to all of a sudden become number one contender without any kind of due diligence. And most of your career has been being able to beat Roman Reigns. Okay, we get that. But then you also lose embarrassing matches to guys who are much smaller than you. It doesn't make any sense. And as Ashley said, he's a transitional champion. Whether he turns heel with Roman Reigns later when Reigns is healthy or feeling healthy enough to come back, that could happen. I don't see what kind of plan you could have for at least one pay-per-view out. It doesn't make any sense. Now, the match itself, short but sweet, the way we all wanted it. I don't understand why Goldberg still has security walking him to the ring. Could someone please cue me in on that?
I did laugh at that. When he opened the door really quick, did you look behind him? And it was just, yes. Like, I mean, obviously it wasn't a locker room, but I was curious to see, like, what he was going to come out of. And it was just like this random open space. It was just very comical. I got a kick out of that.
I thought that was hilarious. I'm like, it made sense in WCW in the 90s because, you know, the NWO was out there, so he had his own security and nobody knew who he was until he cut his first promo. But now we know who he is. He doesn't need security. He's the
and
one
they walked him like 5 feet.
I know. He's supposedly the Achilles heel to Brock Lesnar. I kind of like that, even though it's not good, but he's the one guy that can beat him. So it's like he's supposed to be this ultimate tough guy, yet he needs two guys who, I'm not a big guy, and they really didn't intimidate me. You know, need to walk him to the ring in an empty arena. That stuff's got to go. But, it wasn't sloppy as much as it was forced. You could tell it was forced. Let's do this. Let's get it over with. Let's just get the pin. I could see that on both competitors. I could see it in their eyes. That was the story that was told to me in the ring. It was over. It's done. I just don't see any plans for Stroman going forward, or I see the Universal Championship becoming the under of the two titles. So that's what I got to say.
And Matt, can I say something really quick before you? I'm so sorry. But no, I think I just had a revelation. I think what kind of put me in a bad mood with this match going into it really quick is the way they made the announcement for Roman's replacement on SmackDown. I was flabbergasted when it was just this, oh, by the way, type thing. And so, right, they set up this big thing, like they have breaking news, and it's this whole big deal. And they end up talking about Elias, and they're not sure if he's going to make it to WrestleMania, whatever. And then it's like, oh, by the way, Braun Strowman is now facing Goldberg at WrestleMania. And then they transition into something else, and then that's it. So I was walking out of my bedroom to go get a drink or something, and then it was like a matter of fact type thing. So I came back in thinking we're going to see like a graphic or something, because I was really curious to see if they were going to have like Roman send in a video, if they're going to have like just how they're going to handle it. Because I feel like they could have really used this situation as a huge positive for Roman. They could have had not a whole segment dedicated to him, but had at least like maybe 5 minutes. And not say the words leukemia and coronavirus and all that stuff, but say, hey, due to his previous medical history, which, by the way, we all know because they've mentioned it on TV numerous times, and he's obviously been on Raw addressing it, they could have said, hey, due to his previous medical conditions or just the situations that are going on in the world, everyone deemed it's best for Roman to kind of sit this out, or whatever wordage you want to use for it, and just pretty much stay home until this blows by. It's just in his best interest, and have Roman send in this video about how he misses us, and it was, you know, the hardest decision he's had to make, or second of his career, and just really build this up to a big babyface moment, and then just have that feeling that the next time we see Roman, that he kind of made this big triumphant return again, right? So I think that kind of blew it for me too, because they didn't even bother to build up Strowman. Like, they didn't really take care of Roman in this situation, which I don't know if he shouldn't have done the Instagram video. Whatever. But you had a real opportunity to, even more so than at any other time, have him shine as a babyface and just have that more feel-good moment for him. And in the same token, build up Braun. Have like a quick video package saying this is, and not even announce Braun, but say, hey, Roman's, you know, say what you're going to say about Roman. He's not going to be able to make it. And then lead into it, and this is Goldberg's new opponent, and this is who's next for Goldberg. And then have a video package on Strowman just looking like a monster, and then move on. So I think that kind of like played into it for me too. It's like they didn't even bother to build up Strowman. Like, yeah, the previous weeks, like, he's looked like whatever, but man, at least on Friday, put some type of video package together for him. It's just, I'm sorry. It's just that really, really bothered me.
Well, I got a good question for you, actually. Would this have worked better for you if they had Roman Reigns announce it via satellite, and then he says that he wants to give his spot away to somebody, but he wants to give it to his toughest opponent, and he kind of cuts a promo on the one man who's always cleanly beat him, and then the camera could pan over and it'd be Braun Strowman, and he asked Braun Strowman to do it for him.
Something like that, absolutely, because that kind of plays into it too. It's that situation is probably even better. It's two birds, one stone. You have Roman addressing the situation. you know, and saying how whatever he wants to say about it, and then saying, yeah, like, and everyone knows. And even if you've kind of forgotten, like, they had a long, long rivalry back and forth. I forget what year it was, but I think that was one of Roman's first breakout feuds once the Shield broke out, one of his first individual feuds. So, yeah. And then that would have been a very good idea as well. It's just, I think that kind of just like dampened it for me too. So I'm sorry, Matt. I didn't mean to steal your spot there, but it just kind of bothered me.
I'm still here, guys. So no, it's all good. It's all good. You guys are planting a lot of ideas in my head. That's awesome. I'm not going to give a long-winded answer because you guys said a lot that I agree with. And Ashley, that is the whole issue that I have with this, is they couldn't have even told us how he earned this. Like, they just did it matter-of-fact, kind of on the sly. They didn't decide to even tell us he won a rock-paper-scissors tournament. Like, I would have been like, all right, well, he won rock-paper-scissors, fine. Like that. Right. But should I be surprised that WWE did this? No. That's the sad thing. I'm not even surprised that they did this. I'm annoyed, but it's my typical frustration with their booking. They couldn't have even given us a reason why he was selected. And we all know the real reason why Roman Reigns is not in the match. But don't hide it. You don't have to, like you said, you don't have to bring attention to the virus, but you can just say, due to the circumstances, blah, 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 Roman Reigns has decided for the well-being of his health and his family to pull out of this match. We would have been like, fine. And then the fans wouldn't have any type of resentment towards Roman Reigns for his decision, nor should anybody. But then you could have got him over on air, giving us the reason why, which nobody in their right mind would hopefully disagree with. And then, like you said, the perfect way to select Braun Strowman would be, you know, I've decided to pull out due to the reasons, but I've also been given the authority by management to handpick my replacement and put Braun Strowman in because he was given that authority by management. And then, boom, you could have done this in 30 seconds and have him send it in via Instagram like he's been doing. And instead, they just go, yep, Braun Strowman's replacing Braun Strowman is now got the Universal Championship match at WrestleMania. So you're in one of the main events of WrestleMania, and you were just gifted it with no explanation. Like, that is the problem I have with this whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as the match goes, it was exactly what I think we all thought it was going to be. Although at the beginning, they actually had a couple of moves that weren't finishers in, I think, a clothesline and an Irish whip into the ropes.
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken, there were other moves.
They were training. They were prepping for this match.
There might have been a big boot. I'm not positive.
What did J.R. used to say? They went away and learned a new hold?
Yeah, exactly. But as I think JBL, and we didn't even talk about JBL, but I think he said, you know, the old adage goes that they're not being paid by the hour. And he let everyone know right up front, you know, that these guys aren't being paid by the hour. And it was actually good to hear JBL. As much as I don't like him on a personal level for the things that I've heard about him, he is a nice, fresh voice on commentary. I don't dislike him on commentary.
And it was much needed for that show. Michael needed someone else.
Yes.
Not that he's bad, but it's just you can't talk by yourself for that type of show for 3+ hours.
Yeah, agreed. And so JBL, I think, was a positive to the show. I wish he would have stayed. The entire show would have been fine with it. He's always great on the mic. So as far as the match goes, yeah, it was exactly what we expected. And as far as the Fiend losing, but Braun Strowman is able to get up, you know, we haven't got an explanation or any kind of really rebuttal to the Fiend's loss. He hasn't spoken about it, but I would always say that why doesn't the Fiend say that he decided to lose because it was a sacrifice for what he wanted to do to John Cena, that he wanted to drop the belt? I mean, there's ways to get around it, but yeah, I don't think they'll go there. But Braun Strowman winning is, honestly, it's probably the best decision they could have made given the alternative of Goldberg retaining. Even though I predicted Goldberg to retain, I understand why Strowman won, because they can't have Goldberg on a weekly basis then building up for the next opponent, eventually to get to Roman Reigns. But we have no idea when that's going to be, because it could be, you know, July, August, September. We have no idea when this whole thing is going to end. So I think having Goldberg drop the belt to Braun Strowman is the lesser of two evils, I would say, because now Braun Strowman can be a guy that's there on a weekly basis. The only problem is, or the only disappointment I have beyond how the hell did he get this opportunity, is I was really looking forward to Sami Zayn and Braun Strowman one-on-one at WrestleMania. I know they never announced it, But based on the Elimination Chamber, of how Braun Strowman has never been able to get his hands on Sami Zayn, and Sami Zayn just being that loudmouth guy that has backup, that he never gets his mouth shut. And I believe they were building towards Sami Zayn and Braun Strowman one-on-one at Mania. I'm actually kind of disappointed we didn't get that match. I don't know about you guys.
I would like to see it, honestly, because Sami Zayn is one hell of a performer, and that's not a pun on his finisher, but he is a great performer. And honestly, I think he's been wasted on the main card, the main roster so much. I understand why they did the managerial rule long. He got to heal his body and everything else, which is smart. But, like I said, associating with somebody like Mojo Rawley doesn't help him. I don't like the fact that it's going to become prevalent sooner or later that he is a foreigner. He's from Canada and of, Palestinian descent. And he's palling around with Nakamura and Cesaro. I just don't want to see the League of Nations 2.0. With that being said, though, he could have a great match with Strowman. And I look at Strowman's best matches, it was with those small guys. It's kind of like a Brock Lesnar thing. With when he wrestled Apollo Crews, some of the stuff they did, it was great. And I really think he could have extracted so much more out of Braun Strowman. Had such a beautiful match. Maybe not a five-star, maybe not Savage and Steamboat, but I think that they could have done some stuff in an empty arena. I'm not stipulation heavy, but, bend the rules a little bit, have some fun with it. I think that they could have really done something special.
Yeah, and I guess I'll kind of use this to transition into Sammy's match. I agree with both you guys. I think they definitely, and I think that probably could have been Braun Strowman's best match versus Sammy one-on-one. With no outside interference, no BS. I think that could have been a very, very good match. And maybe that's kind of, again, another reason why I was kind of like a little sour going into his match last night with Goldberg. Just because, again, like there was no follow-up with that. And maybe they were planning on it, and with everything changing, that obviously changed those plans. And if so, then that's fine. And maybe I shouldn't be as hard. But, it's just like he lost to Sammy, and he was, furious. And all this time he was spinning, trying to get his hands on Sammy, and he never did. And Sammy won the title from him, and then now that was it. Like, there was really nothing after that. So I think that was just kind of like a little bit of, which, again, none of this is Braun's, like, his character's fault. It's just, like, the storytelling and, like, the lack of follow-through. Which isn't his fault, but I guess we could say that for a lot of different things. But speaking of Sammy, what did you guys think of his match with Daniel Bryan? Did it meet your expectations? Were you disappointed? What did you guys think?
Honestly, I was a little bit disappointed.
Yeah.
And I think when you look at this on paper, you think Sami Zayn, Daniel Bryan, this could be a burn it down, no pun intended, type of match. They could have really, really just made this one of the classics. And I think the problem with this was Sami Zayn went through a character change of being this kind of heelish, manager type of guy. And with his character change comes a change in his style in ring. I don't think you could have had the very competitive, one-on-one type of who's going to win, who's the best man type of match with these two because of the character change of Sami Zayn, the way that he's been presented. He was the heelish manager, for lack of a better term, that has not had a whole lot of in-ring time, uses other guys to keep his championship, of which Shinsuke Nakamura main evented WrestleMania 2 years ago, and now he's relegated to just the lackey of Sami Zayn, so take that for what it's worth. And now you have Sami Zayn in this different type of presentation. So they had to build it around how Sami Zayn's character has morphed and changed into what it is today. So I think his character change actually limited the match. I like the outcome. I will tell you that. I like the fact that Sami Zayn kept the title. I don't think Daniel Bryan needs it at this point. It's nice that he's in a championship match, but I think Sami Zayn is on something special here with his new character, and has breathed new life into himself. It was the right decision, at least in my eyes, to have Sami retain the IC championship. Michael?
I 100% agree, because I'm tired of hot potato with the undercard belts. It's disgusting to me because they used to mean something. And like I said, Savage Steamboat, that was a match to watch. anything in the old WCW days with the U.S. titles, those were things to watch because these were your next prevalent stars. That was before Money in the Bank and Royal Rumble and all those stipulations. With that being said, I expected a lot more out of this match, as you did. I'm disgusted by the fact that Cesaro and Nakamura are incredibly greatly talented wrestlers that are just mind-blowing, and they're lackeys. Like you said, they're lackeys, and these guys should be doing something and not an Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. They should be doing something like really great, and it's just sad to see them relegated to that situation. I noted that Sami Zayn is really looking like Fidel Castro these days. I thought it, you said it, or no, the other way around. I do like the fact that Drew Gulak is getting the rub here. And it reminds me of how Buddy Murphy got the rub. And while it's a different path, I like the fact that Gulak is going to become somebody out of this. He's the person who's actually going to get elevated down the road. And he's probably going to be the person that has the program with Sami Zayn, which it'll be fresh. It'll be fun. I've followed Gulak for years. I know what he can do. I think he'll be great. My other thing was, why did Gulak try to start a yes chant to nobody? Why?
Well, not nobody. We had Gronk and we had Mojo up there. Don't worry.
Well, in my opinion, they're pretty much nobody. So that was just terrible. And by the way, take off your sunglasses when you're inside, because there's only two people who wear sunglasses when they're inside a building: blind people and jerks. So that's what I got in the match.
Oh, well, his future is just too bright. I mean, that's just what it is.
Corey Hart me.
Yeah, I know we haven't really touched on Gronk and Mojo, but I think, and I tweeted this out because I think it's true yesterday, that Gronk had his sunglasses on because he was reading lines off a cue card at the beginning of the show. I mean, just listen to that. I mean, you could insert any host into that spot and they would have said the exact same thing. So he put sunglasses on as well. Oh, well, he's all into partying, but it was, I also think, because he was reading off cue cards behind the camera. I mean, listen to his whole speech at the beginning. So
I'll have to rewatch that and check that out. But yeah, I don't want to say that this match completely fell flat for me. I just think that both gentlemen could have done a lot better. I don't think it's like one of those situations where they needed the live crowd. I just think that it was another situation where I think it was forced. It didn't seem like they were natural. It just kind of felt like, okay, let's do this. Let's do this. We've got 10 minutes. Is it 10 minutes yet? Kind of thing.
Ashley, any final thoughts before we get to the next match?
No, I think one of the things that stood out to me though with that match was the lack of time that they had, because it was, I don't even think, I think it was under 10 minutes. I think that was the thing that really stood out to me. I was really disappointed that they weren't given more time, and I think that may have had a factor into it. And granted, they're two of the best in-ring workers, so they can make you in a 5-minute in-ring match work. So I'm not sure exactly what it was, but I was definitely, this was one of the matches in-ring wise I was definitely looking forward to and I thought could possibly steal the show. So I was just a little underwhelmed with it, but I think my underwhelming feeling was just the lack of time that they had. But I think really quick before we move on, I think that I kind of see this being like maybe the end of their feud with Sammy and Sammy's gang. I think that Gulak and Brian may break out into like a tag team role and maybe go after Miz and Morrison for the titles. I would definitely be down to see that. But I would also love to see Gulak go for the Intercontinental title, because he definitely deserves that. But I would maybe right now be entertained by a tag team.
And God knows WWE, or SmackDown especially, needs a new, fresh set of tag teams.
Yeah, especially with Miz and Morrison retaining. So I think that would be a perfect, you know, next. And you have Miz and Bryan right there as well, so you already have that built into it. So I think that could be a good possibility for them.
Although you did have Cesaro beat Gulak in the kickoff match. I mean, so take that for what it's worth.
True,
I mean, I don't even know. But all right, well, very good. Now comes a match that, at least in my estimation, you guys don't have to follow suit, obviously, but Kevin Owens and Seth Rollins in their match, I think, really tore it down. They had, and I've been waiting for this type of match between these two for quite some time. I know that we've seen them endlessly on Raw face each other, but it's more of like a brawling type of screwing each other over, backstage beatdowns. It hasn't really had a chance to really show what these two are capable of, and I think we got that at least on night one. To me, this match stole the show by a long and wide margin. These two, I mean, you had Kevin Owens literally jumping off of the WrestleMania sign, which people have joked about for years that, you know, Shane McMahon's going to jump off the WrestleMania sign onto Undertaker at 32. I mean, like, we had so many jokes about that happening, and Kevin Owens did it, I think, as a fan service. I believe he did that because of so many times people laughing about, you know, wouldn't it be so funny if so-and-so did that? And he did it, and that was the big spot of the night. And obviously the referee going over to check on both of them in the whole cue of squeeze my hand if you're okay. You know, that's what they're, that's how they obviously are notifying the referee to tell them that they're okay. And they were. And these two really left nothing behind. And I said that the biggest compliment I could give to this match is I forgot there were no fans in the arena. And that to me is how you can show me that you have got me engaged. And they did from start to finish. And to have Kevin Owens win the way he did, we had obviously Seth Rollins hit Kevin Owens in the face with the ring bell. And
it
dinged. Yes, it did. It dinged perfectly. It dinged like you were playing WWE 2K20, and it dinged perfectly. Yeah. And I love that. And I was actually, when that happened and it ended in DQ, I said, I was disappointed. And I said, oh, really? It's going to end like that? Clearly, they're going to extend this feud. And then Kevin Owens gets on the mic and he says, get back here. This is not how this ends. I want this no disqualification. So he comes back. He takes more punishment from Seth. And eventually Seth gets the ring bell in the head. And we have the big spots. We have the stunner finish the match. And I like the way that Seth Rollins sold the stunner there. It wasn't your typical, you know, Scott Hall type of stunner where he when Stone Cold stunned him at WrestleMania 18, it looked like he got shot by a cannon. This was a selling it the way it should be sold because you just got your ass beat and you're really at the end of the match here and he just kind of like flopped to the floor. That to me was a small thing, but it was important. Having Kevin Owens have his WrestleMania moment, I predicted Kevin Owens should win and he did. It was the right move. I believe it was the right move to give Kevin Owens something. Seth can bounce back, no problem. Seth has a resume that reads like a rap sheet at WrestleMania. He has had, I mean, we all know his history at WrestleMania and the things that he's done outside of losing to Randy Orton. He's really not, up until last night, didn't lose at WrestleMania. So this was an important win for Kevin Owens. Kevin Owens needed this way more than Seth Rollins did, and they put on, I think, the match of the night with all of that put together as well. So to me, this was the best match of the night, a great match, and I'm going to toss it to Michael. You go ahead. What did you think of this match?
I loved it. You and I have talked about this building up to it for a while, that there needed to be a stipulation. And it started out as a regular match. And then Kevin Owens gets the DQ win, asks for it to be no disqualification, which is something that you and I have kind of like wanted for a long time. We talked about it, and that's where we got what we wanted. The dive, great. You know, I kind of thought, no, he's not going to do it. And when I saw him appear behind the sign, I was like, he's going to do it. Come on, let's just get it over with. I love the back and forth. These guys can wrestle so great technically, but they can brawl too. And it's like you said, like Rollins can lose and bounce back because his resume speaks for himself. Kevin Owens needed this win. And not only did he needed the DQ win, he needed the decisive win too, because it just cemented the fact that we put an exclamation point on it. This is over. This is done. Or at least if you're going to build from it from now, we really got to do something as far as the faction thing, but it was a great match. Electricity. The thing I noticed the most about this is that they were, and maybe it's that Ring of Honor bond they have with them in the past, did not play to the crowd that wasn't there. They weren't looking to the people. They weren't posing. They weren't waiting for reactions. They were more sunk into each other, which could either be great storytelling in the ring, like, hey, let's just go at each other because we're supposed to hate each other. Or it could be the fact that you know, they just knew there's nobody out here, so let's not pose, let's not have pomp and circumstance, because that's just going to kill the match. So that's the stuff I love. That's trying to see if I have any other notes here. The only thing I really don't like, Seth wearing white. I hate that. And it's kind of funny because, you know, the bad guys wear black, and Kevin Owens was wearing black, and Rollins was wearing white. I don't know if you guys picked up on that whole thing. Like, was it supposed to be a double turn, which we dreaded? But it wasn't. I really enjoyed the whole thing, except for Kevin Owens' shirt. It did not look good. So that's what I got on that one.
As far as Seth's gear, I'm sorry. I kind of dug his white gear. I think his whole entrance and just the look of it, he looked like someone that, like a holy figure, right? Like the way the lights were hitting him. It kind of reminded me of like how when Sheamus comes out and the lights are just beating on him and he's, you know, fairly white complexion and it just like radiates off of him. That's kind of what it looked like with Seth. And I was actually surprised because in an interview a while ago, he had said that Vince hated his white gear. So I'm surprised that they let him wear his white gear again. And I think it kind of played into, in my opinion, it kind of played into like his whole Messiah gimmick. Because white is like you said, like good and like pure and like in his mind and like his twisted version, like that's what he is. Because like he's in his mind, everything that he's doing is the truth and the right way. And so I think in my opinion, like that was kind of what I got out of his white gear. Could be completely off base and he just got the okay to wear white and went with it. But this was my favorite match of the night. I loved it. Like you said, Matt, when it ended in DQ, I was like, wow, they're really going to end this match at WrestleMania in a DQ. And I was like, trying to like come to grips with it. I was like, right, you know, and like you said, it was like, okay, they're going to continue this after tonight. But then when Kevin got on the mic and it played out very well and it was very believable. And I'm not sure if you guys follow Kevin Owens on Twitter or social media, but he had put out a video early yesterday morning or midday, just pretty much saying that, and just like addressing like, you know, the odd times, and he hopes that we enjoy the show and that they care and that they, you know, just pretty much just addressing like the work that they put into it and how all the guys back there really do want it to be a good show for us at home and all that. So it's just one of those things that like it makes you feel good about watching, and it plays well into it, right? Like he's like this good guy on social media that plays into his good guy role on TV. Whereas sometimes like they're like a good person on social media, like, you know, that because that's who they naturally are. And then like on TV, they're supposed to be a bad guy, which is a whole nother conversation in and of itself. But so I obviously saw that yesterday, and it just made me even more excited for that match, and it kind of gave me that feeling like, okay, like he's, you know, because, and he had mentioned like having a WrestleMania moment in his video, so I was like, okay, like he's, something's, you know, he's, they're going to try to do something or just make this match like the best on the show, and man, they delivered. I was just so happy with that match, and I think it was you, Matt, like you said, Seth can take this loss and move on. Kevin definitely needed this moment. He needed this win, and I'm definitely excited that Kevin got the victory here.
No, really. I mean, I don't know what more I can say. This elevated WrestleMania, how I viewed the night as a whole. I mean, this elevated the entire perception of WrestleMania Part 1. I mean, a notch or two, big time. I mean, this was what I wanted to see from WWE when they said they were doing this format of WrestleMania was, you know, give us some of these barn burner matches. They can have the hokey type of sports entertainment-y stuff, which we obviously did with Taker and Styles, but give us something that is a wrestling fan's wrestling that they want to see at Mania, and this was that. This was a in-ring quality product from start to finish. And yes, the white robes, typically, yeah. I mean, traditionally, I mean, you look at movies, TV, and in wrestling, for the most part, white symbolizes good, black symbolizes evil. And while Seth Rollins wore white, I think it was, like you mentioned, Ashley, it's kind of, I think it's actually more evil for his character to wear white because he thinks he's that holier-than-thou character to not even understand or have the self-awareness to realize he's the bad guy in this situation, and to think that he's actually doing good to wear white is actually, I think, more of a sinister thing to do, not even realizing who you are. to not even see it. So I understand your frustration with it, but I do think that that was actually a good thing. He walked down to the ring and had his hands kind of like folded, like he's some kind of priest or like, you know, the second coming of Christ. I love it. I really, this whole Messiah thing, as much as they say the Monday Night Messiah way too much, it's working. I think it's working way better than his babyface character ever has. So any final closing thoughts from Ashley or Michael?
I just want them to drop the word Monday Night on it. Just make him the Messiah, make it cleaner.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because, you know, no, I don't want to hear the Friday Night Messiah. That's just silly. And, you know, I had thought about, like, what we had talked about as far as the white and the black. And as long as he sticks with it, if he doesn't wear the white only for pay-per-views and he sticks with it, then I can buy into it. But for some reason, I don't know, I've never liked his character in white, no matter if he's babyface, heel, whatever else. It just never worked with him. I hate to say I agree with Vince McMahon on something, but if it's going to build something more, I'm all for it. I like where his character is going, and this is the ending argument on this is, do you guys want this to end now, or do you want it to stretch out a little bit more and include, you know, I hate to say the Messiah Maniacs, because that's a terrible name. I'd rather call them the Gathering or the Flock or whatever else, something else that's better than the Maniacs. And whatever Kevin Owens can kind of get as a following going forward.
Well, I think AOP, one of them is out getting, has to have surgery. And I think there's something going on with Buddy Murphy as well. I don't remember exactly what happened with him. I just remember someone saying that he wasn't going to be able to tape for a while or whatever. So I think this may be it for now, at least a group version of each side.
Okay.
I could be wrong, but I know for sure one of the AOP members has to get surgery. I think on their shoulder or something like that. But I'm not 100% sure on Buddy Murphy, but I believe someone said that he's out as well. But I don't really know like what they would do after this, either together or separately for that matter. Especially now with the weird scheduling and the amount of people that you can have. Like, I think scheduling-wise for, like, Monday, they have to pick, like, maybe, like, one or two feuds to progress each night, just, like, with the limitation on the amount of people that they can have. So I think we may not see Kevin or Seth on Raw, maybe on Raw this week. And I don't even know what they're going to do taping-wise for the foreseeable future. But so I think it's kind of hard to answer that one just because we don't really know who can do what right now. What about you, Matt?
I'm not sure either. And, you know, this would signal to me when the babyface goes over clean, especially at WrestleMania, typically that's the end of the feud. I mean, that traditionally tells me everything's done. It's over. You know, we got to the top of the mountain. We got the blow off. Here's what you wanted to see. So if they continue this, I mean, I mean, I'm okay with it because it seems to work with these two. And now they've shown you they can put on a really good match and it is on the biggest stage that you have. So maybe last night while they positioned and formatted this match to do to be the blow off and they're going to move on. Maybe they said, hey, wait a minute. We're getting some really, really good fan reaction from this and they're going to try to find a way to extend it. Now, that would also depend on whether or not WWE has already taped the Monday Night Raw after WrestleMania. I would assume that they have from everything I've heard. And if they have, then they've already decided whether or not this program is going to continue. I would assume not, but because I don't know where they each go from here. But this is the new season, right? This is the new season of wrestling after WrestleMania, the Monday night after. So I'm okay if they do, but I don't think they will based on how WrestleMania went.
Okay.
All right. So let's move on. And a few matches left here, and then we'll wrap things up. We have, I'm scared to touch that match. Let's go to the Triple Threat Ladder Match with John Morrison defeating Kofi Kingston and Jimmy Uso to retain the SmackDown Tag Team Championship. Ashley, you're first.
I think the finish was pretty creative. Definitely style points there. And, man, for these guys to go out and do what they did for literally no one in the building. It's just amazing, and I kudos to them for everything that they did, and I'm sure they are feeling it, well, whenever they aired the next day, or whenever they originally filmed this. Probably still feeling it now. But it's just amazing, and John Morrison, man, he is just unreal. Like, just the walking on the top rope, it's just everything that he did is just, and of course Kofi Kingston, all of them, but it's just John Morrison really stuck out last night. Maybe it's because we haven't seen him on WWE TV in a while and in that type of environment. But I think for the situation that they were in, they couldn't have asked for three better guys to perform that type of match. I think it was just the perfect guys were in there for everything that was surrounding the match. I just think it played out very well. And I think the right team won. I think Miz and Morrison needed to retain here because they just won. Morrison just came back. And you need a heel tag team champions for SmackDown's roster. Like you mentioned earlier, it's pretty thin as it is, but I don't even know what other heel tag team that they have. So if they were to have lost, then it's just a matter of going back and forth. So I loved the match. It was probably my second favorite match of the night. I'm definitely here for it. What about you guys?
All right. This isn't going to be very nice, but I'm just going to say it. I want to say it. First of all, I've watched John Morrison when he was released for many years, when he was Johnny Mundo, Johnny Impact, Johnny everything. And watching him in a ladder match, being governed for what he can do, and doing the same things he did 10 years ago does nothing for me. He is so incredibly talented. And I wanted this result to happen. I wanted Miz and Morrison to retain, only because John Morrison deserves better. He's locked into mediocrity. He left years ago because he was locked into mediocrity, and he's back in the same thing, a tag team program with The Miz, who does nothing for anybody. And so I feel, first of all, it's silly for us to have a tag team match defined by a singles competition. That just is silly. There's other ways around it. You can find a substitute partner. I know it doesn't fit it, but the fact is it's a tag team match. This is what kills belts. This is what kills championships, what kills meaning. With that being said, entertaining match, middle of the road. It wasn't a Hardy's, Edge and Christian kind of ladder match, barn burner. It was fun. It was great to watch. But seeing Kofi and Morrison wrestle so, what's the term I want to say, PG, compared to what they can really do and how you can really just ungovern them, it's mind-blowing, the difference. With that being said, I didn't want to see the New Day. I didn't want to see the Usos. They've had their time. They need to really scramble the stuff up. You need more tag teams. The right decision was to keep it on Miz and Morrison, but John Morrison is a superstar as a singles. He does need to refresh his look a little bit, something new, and what we saw, even with him wrestling under the WWE guidelines version of him, was still really amazing. The rope walk, like you said, the ending. What was that whole Mr. Perfect reference by JBL, by the way? I didn't get that. But point being, it was a solid match. It wasn't what they could do. I think if it was in front of a live audience and they could call an audible, we would have seen something a little bit more amazing. That's my thoughts.
Yeah, so I think that this match, it delivered. I think from an in-ring perspective, it's what we thought it was going to be, and that's a car crash match, and that's a compliment, because many people, when they watch a ladder match, they expect guys in bodies and steel to meet, and we certainly saw that, and I don't think there was a lack of effort on anyone's part. I think these guys are waking up, or did wake up on March 27th, which is the day after they did this, very sore and bruised and battered, and the effort from all involved was, I think, to be commended. And actually, I like that there wasn't six guys in this match, that there was only three. It was a cleaner, easier to follow type of match. We didn't get the complicated spots that, you know, when you have six guys in there trying to set up, you know, 16 ladders and you know, you have ladders on top of ladders and all this kind of stuff. It was easier to digest with three guys rather than six. So I actually like this better than if all members were involved. And having John Morrison and The Miz retain, The way that they retained was creative. I've never seen that finish before. And you couldn't put the belts on New Day. You can't put them on the Usos. I actually would like to see the Usos and New Day just stop interacting. I don't need to see these two teams every single week be involved in some kind of, well, we're friends, but we're respected. You know, we respect each other's abilities. And every time we get together, we have, you know, great matches instead of, oh, by the way, we should worry about winning the match instead of having great matches. That's neither here nor there. But I don't need these two teams together anymore. Having Daniel Bryan and Drew Gulak as a team, yes, yes, yes. We need new teams to interact with the whole division. So Miz and Morrison made sense that they retain. Whenever the Miz, I guess, you know, he's in quarantine, not feeling well. I mean, whenever he returns, they can hopefully have new opponents. I don't need multi-team opponents anymore. Miz and Morrison should just go on their run with a new tag team. And I don't know, maybe it is Heavy Machinery. I don't know. But there needs to be some new, fresh teams in here instead of just, it's the New Day or it's Usos. It's the New Day or it's Usos. Neither one need the belts right now. So those are my thoughts. But I'd give the match a thumbs up. I really would. I'd give it a strong thumbs up because of the effort and because of the creative finish and because it was the right team that won.
One thing I will say is, did you notice this is like the first ladder match in forever where we didn't see the slow climb?
Yes. Yes, I did see that.
I was so happy about that. I was like, oh my God, they're like running up the ladder as fast as possible, but somebody will, you know, you get Morrison or Kofi like jumping from the ropes onto the ladder right where they are. I love that placing. I love that timing. It was more believable. It wasn't that, oh my God, I can't make it. I just body slammed a 300-pound man, but I can't climb up the ladder. I love it. I love that part of it.
Yeah, we can have John Morrison do Starship Pain, but he can't put one foot in front of the other to climb up a ladder. I mean, like, we didn't get that. Yeah, I know. Something that was just really an Achilles heel every single time, or like cage matches, when they just can't, you know, run to the door and open the door. They just have to crawl there. It's like they're in mud. I mean, that kind of stuff really bothers me, and we didn't get that, and I appreciate that. Yeah, that's a good point.
And one more thing, just before we move on, to kind of go along with what you guys were saying, I'm pretty sure I'm right on this, but the only time that they actually either touched the titles or the little, what looks like a sturdy hanger that holds them, is when it was the finish of the match and they were going to grab the actual titles and win. Whereas before, like, they'll grab onto it, maybe swing from it, but for whatever reason, they can't pull it down. But, like, you can sit there and hold on to the contraption. But the only time that they touched it last night was when it was actually time for the finish. So
yes.
I love little things like that as well. Or it may have happened one other time, like a fingertip type thing, but I'm pretty sure that was the only time.
That's such a small thing, and I don't even know if it was by design or not, but how many times, I would say 95% of the ladder matches that we see are, you know, the guys get up there or girls get up there and it's like a Rubik's Cube. They're like, how do I do this? How do I unhook, you know, one hook from the other? It's just silly. And we didn't get that last night. Those are small things, but they make such a big difference in believability and engaging yourself into the match and not just going, okay, these guys are world-class athletes and they just can't unhook something or figure out how to climb a ladder quickly. I mean, so that, the big, big things that are so small, but they make a big difference in my mind, subconsciously or not. So, all right, moving on to the next match here. And guys, I'm very, very concerned about your reviews for this, but maybe I'm wrong. And Becky Lynch versus Shayna Baszler for the Raw Women's Championship. Shayna Baszler losing to Becky Lynch. I have a feeling there's going to be some strong opinions, or maybe not. So, Michael, You first on this one. What did you think of Shayna retaining and the quality of the match as well? Or I'm sorry, Becky retaining and the quality of the match.
The quality of the match was mediocre at best, and honestly, this was a terrible, terrible decision. It's Baszler's time, but it goes beyond that. It's just the fact that at this point, Becky Lynch is going to be overexposed. If we see you every day, we're not going to miss you if you don't go away. She needs a break. I will not take anything away from her. She stays healthy. She goes out there every week. She performs, and she's great. But by definition, too much of the same thing over and over again repetitively is going to make you bored of it, and that's what's going to happen. And I don't know if they just weren't sure enough that it was time to pull the trigger or not, but this was definitely Baszler's time. And I just – felt that this was another situation where it was like, all right, we have so many minutes, let's go out there and do this. And, you know, I saw a lot of the submission, you know, moves up front and everything like that, but it was missing something. It was missing some grit, just a little bit more grit. You know, I'm supposed to believe that Shayna Baszler is like a cage fighter, which she is, and she is legitimately, you know, a tough girl, and that's not taking anything away from Becky Lynch, but maybe a little color would have helped this match something. But it just went by. It went in the wrong direction. I get the pin. I get it. It looks like it's a buildup for around Ronda Rousey return. Like, I can fluke pin you from anywhere, but I didn't like it. And I really wish that Baszler would have won.
Ashley.
My jaw dropped when Becky won. I was shocked. If I had to make a bet on any match, I probably would have made a bet on that one. And I'm so happy that situation didn't happen, because I obviously would have been wrong. I was shocked. Like, in my mind, they did this because this is the beginning of a Becky heel turn, or maybe a double turn. I don't even know if Ronda's, because maybe the initial plan was to have Ronda come back, maybe for like SummerSlam time frame. But with everything going on, I don't know if that's been put on hold. And I don't even really want to think about Ronda right now. I just want to think of Shayna and Becky. In my head, the only way to justify it, because with the landscape as it is right now, who does Becky face? Like, there's literally no one left on Raw for her to face. And that was part of the reason in my head Shayna had to win. Besides all of Shayna's accolades to the side, like, there's literally no one else for Becky to face. Unless you go right back to the rematch, which is fine. But in my mind, Becky retained last night the way she did to start a heel turn. Because now Shayna can go back and say, oh, well, you didn't pin me clean, just like you didn't pin Ronda clean. And just kind of go that route. But for someone who loves Becky Lynch and is a big Becky Lynch fan, I was so disappointed that she retained last night. And I think she broke some type of record or whatever. And granted, she does deserve to be champion. But, man, if this isn't the start of a heel turn or a double turn for both characters, I'm just at a loss for what you do with Becky. Like, I hate to be so down on it, because the match was, I guess, fine, but even I was just expecting more of a badass Shayna, like, coming out, and I'm just so disappointed, because when I had the whole Becky and Shayna WrestleMania match envisioned back in January, the build was simple. Like, you have Shayna coming in, she's this almost indestructible beast coming up from NXT, was pretty much running the division for however long, a year plus. And just this incredible monster. Oh, and by the way, she's best friends with Ronda Rousey, who, by the way, had this built-in story with Becky for however long. So it was just the simplest thing. And I'm just at a loss for why they did what they did. And I'm trying to remain hopeful that they have this big story planned out for it. But, man, as of right now, I am just so, so upset with with what happened. What about you, Matt?
Yeah.
And I hate to be negative about it.
No, I mean, so if you take the roles out of it, meaning heel, babyface, and I'll get to that in a minute. If you just looked at it from a wrestling perspective, it was an average match. If I was going to put a gun in my head, I'd say a thumbs up match, barely. It didn't make me go, that was awful, in terms of the match quality. It just made me go, you know, I expected better. It was kind of like that. And it was physical. They certainly tried.
Kind of like the Bryan and Gulak match.
Yeah. Yeah. Or the Bryan and Zayn match. Exactly. I don't think anyone was blown away by the quality of the match. I wasn't. They told a decent story. Again, it was kind of like a C+ is what I'd give it in terms of the match quality. Now, when you look at who won and why, Yeah, if you're going to do a Becky Lynch heel turn, makes sense. If you're going to continue with the babyface character, then she's got no one left to work with, as you said, Ashley. If she turns heel, she's got a fresh new roster to work with because you have all faces now to work with. But if they're going to do that, it seems like it's a slow turn. And I don't even know if they're going that way because she beat Shayna clean. It wasn't a tap out, which would have, I think, been worse for Shayna. This was a fluke pin. So you could build it as, and Shayna could build this as, you escaped me, you didn't beat me. Kind of like Samoa Joe did with Brock Lesnar at SummerSlam a few years ago. He told Brock, you escaped me, you didn't beat me. So maybe she could go that road, and so that's how you give Shayna an out. She never tapped out to the disarmer. That would have been absolutely disastrous. But you have Shayna, who just dominated the Elimination Chamber, went through women like a hot knife through butter. There was no way during that match in the Elimination Chamber that she was ever in danger of losing. It was a decimation of the entire women's roster. And then to have her go in and basically go toe-to-toe with Becky, and Becky is, you know, taking over, and it was too standard of a match. When you have the story told at Elimination Chamber, it didn't flow well into the WrestleMania match. You should have had, if I was billing this and you're going to have Becky win, what I would have done is have Shayna just decimate Becky from, you know, pillar to post for 90% of the match, where Becky is in trouble. She's getting beat down. She's trying to escape holds. She's doing everything she can to survive, and Shayna's just beating her down, beating her down, beating her down. And then you get this fluke pin. Not pulling the tights, just happen to seemingly get lucky, and then it's the 1-2-3, and Shayna kicks out at, you know, 3.5. And Shayna's shocked, and Becky is, you know, up the ramp, you know, basically with her life in her hands. And instead, we kind of got a, you know, 60-40 Shayna dominated match, but it wasn't even a kick out after. It was just Shayna got pinned, and she got pinned clean. So you're not telling the story that you should probably tell, unless this is a heel turn. If this was a heel turn, you have, again, a ton of new people to work with. So Becky winning, I said this was a possibility if you're going to turn her heel. And I just don't know who in the hell she works with now. I mean, you could, it's seemingly Shayna Baszler as a follow-up, you could go to one more time and then maybe do a double turn. But outside of that, she's run through everybody else, everyone. I mean, name somebody else that's even worth competing with Becky Lynch at this point, unless you do a roster shakeup in which maybe she could go to SmackDown or something like that. But this is a very interesting decision. Many people were angry. I'm not as angry as most people, but the follow-up here is key. The follow-up will determine how I feel. So I'm initially surprised, but I'm not angry if this is leading to something bigger.
I hope it is, because honestly, at this point, the thing that really sucked the air out of the room is when they zoomed in on Baszler after the match, and she looked almost like she was teary-eyed. You took a monster, and you made a monster look teary-eyed. Just because she took a fluke pin, there's so many better ways to paint this canvas, and they just did not paint. It was just throwing anything and hoping the noodles stuck, you know, whatever analogy you want to use. It's the fact that we don't know what's going to happen going forward. Hopefully it's a rematch, and hopefully Baszler gets her due, but this deserves something more. This was nowhere near as monstrous as it should have been. If there was another match that should have had color, it should have been this one. I would love to have seen it, because I think they're both tough enough. But the fact that it's like you said, Baszler at Elimination Chamber was unstoppable. So we have this just beast going in and then becomes Butterfingers and gets rolled up after a couple of good moves. Come on, man. And then looking so sad. It was that sad look. I hated it. That's how you kill a character. That's not how you begin a character. That's just my thoughts.
Yeah, my final thought, just real quick, what I did also think last night after I kind of realized what actually happened, my thought also is maybe they're holding on to that moment of actually crowning her and letting her beat Becky until we can actually get into an arena again, excuse me, and just to have that feel-good moment there. So that was something that did cross my mind. That just could be out of the box on them and not something that they're really concerned with. But seeing Shayna lose last night kind of, and it may be completely off base, maybe concerned with Drew as well. That's a completely other story. But, yeah, that was the only other saving grace maybe, too, that I was trying to tell myself maybe that they're just holding out until we can actually all get in there and celebrate that moment with her. But, like I said, if that's the case, then that's not looking good for Drew.
No, it's not. It's not looking good for Drew. And like you said, Ashley, that's a good point, because had this been in front of a live audience, maybe things would be different. We don't know what WWE had in store prior to the whole outbreak and change of plans. We have no idea if this would have been different and Shayna would have gone over. We have no idea. So we can only judge it on what we've seen and not what could have been. But, yeah, the follow-up is going to be key Monday night. What do they do? Where do they go? How do they present Becky? With her coming in with the semi-truck every single time. Am I supposed to believe she's driving down the highway with this thing? I mean, like, who paid for this? How did she get it? Is she supposed to be kind of like a badass because she has a semi that was painted for $40,000 with her face on it? I mean, I don't know. To me, she is a heel right now anyway, in my mind, because of how she's acted and how arrogant she's been and her goat shirts and her jackets and her stupid sunglasses. To me, she's been a heel for a while. So they just have not done it on air and transparently done it. So I don't know. I'm just... To me, I'll reserve my thoughts for after Monday, how they follow up. That's the whole key. And if they continue down this road, I don't know what they're doing with Becky. I don't know if it's a Ronda setup or not. So, okay, let's move on here. Couple more matches, and then we'll be done here. We then got, Elias defeating King Corbin via pinfall. Honestly, I don't have a long review for this match. Elias went over... It just continues to define down King Corbin, and I don't know why they're doing that. I think Corbin is one of the better heels in the last few 6 months, even maybe more. To me, King Corbin needed this win. He needed to get back on track, especially after losing to Roman Reigns endless times. He needed to beat Elias. Elias, to me, is... Honestly, I don't think Elias is a great babyface. I just don't. I think King Corbin is better at being a heel than Elias is at being a face. So King Corbin needed to win this. It wasn't even that great of a match, to be honest with you. It was kind of a downer moment, a low point in the show. It doesn't have a great backstory anyway. And you have Elias, by the way, coming out there with, I'm not good at medical terms, that tape that he has that usually Cesaro was famous for wearing, like, for months and months and months on end, that I don't know if it's athlete's tape or something that's on his shoulder. And I'm thinking, that's the only spot that you have on your entire body from falling 15
feet? And
that's
stuff that people just normally wear, like, if who haven't actually sustained an injury, like, if their muscles are strained, like, it's like, you... I expected, like, his shoulder to be actually bandaged, or his back, like, you know, tape wrapped around his abdomen. Like,
nothing.
And you just do the shoulder with the whatever.
I'm like, out of all spots. I mean, you do a shoulder? I mean, if he actually had fallen that far, number one, you'd have a concussion, right? And maybe that's... Then I was thinking, oh, maybe that's what they were concerned about in terms of storyline. And he'll come out with a neck brace and, you know, whatever. Nothing. We got a shoulder with that tape that you said people wear, and I believe it. I don't know the technical term for it, but that tape that people wear, as you said, on a routine basis. And it's almost as if, oh, I just, you know, strained a muscle in the gym. No, you fell 15 feet, and that's all you have to show for it? He didn't come limping out. He didn't – nothing. There was no side effects whatsoever, and it was – it made no sense. And so I was unfortunately really down on this match, and especially the outcome where Corbin needed the win. So, Michael, go ahead.
I think we're on the beginning of a double turn on this one, actually. Now, look at it. Elias attacked him with guitar, and he got the win with a bolt. So – you get the win with the roll-up, not a good thing to do if you're a babyface. You attack someone with a guitar, not a good thing to do if you're a babyface, even though that you've been thrown off of a scaffold and the most you can show is a little bit of a Band-Aid on your arm. Now, I think this could actually refresh both characters. Elias, as a heel, when he first came out on the main roster years ago, naturally got himself over as a babyface when people just liked him. Fact is, this guy does not really get to wrestle. And that's the biggest thing that people do not realize is the fact that there's a performer underneath there. If you dig back in the old NXT, there's a performer underneath there. And I saw him at NXT Live years ago. The guy's huge. Now, with that all being said, I think, unfortunately, he's just been part of the mid-card shuffle. Corbin has been a guy that Vince McMahon has been in love with because he's almost 7 feet tall. He thinks that that's what the women want for some reason. I don't know. I've read all these weird different reports. Corbin, you can buy what he was the lone wolf. The King, not so much. The lackey of Kurt Angle, really not so much. And the overexposure of him is what's hurt him. So this could be the most brilliant move they make, is a double turn. Yes, the match was not great. It wasn't anything we're going to talk about for days. But the fact is, you can actually build on this, and you can actually, put together a whole entree, because now we've got a little bit of the side dishes going on with the heel tactics, Corbin complaining about it, Corbin maybe just taking off the crown and saying, screw this, I'm Baron Corbin. And just going forward, exposing him for what he did, this could actually be something that elevates a lower mid-card, because that's what they are. You know, when you get dominated by somebody so many times, or if you're put in 24/7, stipulations and with that whole group, and you're lumped in, this could be something great for both of them. I'm trying to see a silver lining on that. Aside from that, I'm looking at my notes on it. Corbin did have the 40-yard stare for the fans that went there, which I wasn't a fan of. And let's see. I love the female ref getting in Corbin's face. I just love the fact that she just showed no mercy whatsoever and didn't act like she was afraid of him. I love the fact that, they're giving some empowerment to the female referee position. So that's what I got.
Yeah, really quick. This was one of those matches that, in my opinion, didn't need to happen. If no other reason, both characters needed a win, right? Like, and if you're going to continue to build up Elias or have him even be a reasonably respected wrestler and with any type of credibility, you have to give him wins at some time, And I even forget what his actual entrance music sounds like sometimes because you never hear it. Granted, he's always playing the guitar, but he just needs to be in more matches and he needs to get more victories if he's actually going to be in matches. Or if you're just going to have him as an entertainer playing the guitar, then just go in that direction with him. But if you want him to be in the ring, then he needs to win at some point. And the same thing with Baron Corbin. He just came off of this long feud with Roman Reigns, and he's just kind of been, floating, doing really nothing since then. And to continue his momentum, if you want to go that route, he needs a victory as well. So for a lot of reasons, I just think that they maybe should have held off on this match. But the bright side, I did like the little bit of aggression that we did see from Elias at one point in the match. That was kind of refreshing. And I have been a fan of Elias. I think he does have potential if they would just give him a push or just at least not have him be a joke 1 week and try to take him serious the next week. So just pick a route that you want to go with him and just stay the course. But it was just one of those matches, in my opinion, that they maybe could have held off on. But it was fine for what it was, and, just moved on to the next.
Agreed. This is a match, I don't even know. This isn't WrestleMania worthy to me. This is like house show SmackDown maybe worthy. And you had, I should have seen the outcome coming based on Gronk basically getting the best of Corbin on SmackDown a couple weeks ago and making him look like a fool, which WWE has a terrible habit of making celebrities look like, a $1 million and their in-house wrestlers look like fools every time they bring a celebrity in. And Elias also picked the fight. And that to me, he's the one that was backstage constantly interrupting Corbin and goading him into this match. I mean, he's the one that was being the bully to Corbin. When you think about it, he's the one that was poking the bear at Corbin to have this match. So I didn't like the setup. I don't like Gronk being involved. I don't like anything about Gronk to begin with, personally. I mean, I have no interest in Gronk being a babyface. If he's a heel and someone ends up dropping him, fine. But I don't need him, WWE positioning him as this likable party guy who is, in his 30s or 40s now, still living his pledging days, right? I don't need that. And that's what I look at Gronk as, an immature 40-year-old man who is still living in college. And I don't like that. That is extremely – it just is – it's not appealing at all to me. So I don't like the way that they're positioning him, especially Mojo Rawley, who's now the 24/7 champion. I mean, like, the championship, 24/7 championship should just probably live – or, I'm sorry, just probably be buried with AJ in that grave. I mean, I'm kind of over the 24/7 championship at this point. And having Mojo Rawley out there, he's kind of the same way. These two are extremely obnoxious. They're not likable. You want somebody to, I was hoping someone would just come and push them off the ledge during their intro or their segment with R-Truth. Somebody, please, just push them over the ledge.
Well, if I may interject for one second, Baron Corbin was a professional football player, just like Mojo, just like Gronk. I think that's why they're all lumped together in this. They have that football kind of, we're all making so happy. That's what it is, and I hate it. Go ahead.
No, I'm with you. In general, I'm not going to beat a dead horse because this feud is hopefully dead, and they both move on to something else. This was a very down – it wasn't a bad match. It's just everything about it. The setup was bad. The outcome I didn't like. Gronk being involved that doubles down on the bad. So the whole thing, just give him a mulligan, redo it, move on, and hopefully that's the end of this. But unfortunately, I don't think it is, but I hope it is. All right, well, moving on, and something that I actually enjoyed was the first match of the night, beyond the kickoff of Cesaro and Drew Gulak. We had Alexa Bliss and Nikki Cross defeat the Kabuki Warriors via pinfall. I actually didn't enjoy I shouldn't say this. I don't think that Kairi Sane was particularly inspired. She looked like she was going through the motions. She hasn't said a whole lot. Yeah. Yes.
Dude, I had to go back and rewatch it because the way she just threw down her fan or her umbrella, whatever it was, I was just, wow, she just looked so unmotivated. And maybe that's just the heel side she was trying to go with. Mm-hmm. And if that's the case, whatever she was trying to do, it stood out to me because I was good. And that's what was so confusing because Asuka was her normal self, right? Just doing her thing, waving the fan. And then Kairi is just like so uninterested and did not want to be there. I was just shocked. And I was wondering if anyone else noticed it.
Oh, no. Did you notice that, Michael?
I'm just going to say it. I thought she might have been, a little high, something like that. Just disinterested, like you said, like in her own haze, in her own world.
Yeah, I think, she just seemed she just wanted to be anywhere but there. And it came across on TV. Think about it. I mean, she's made it clear before that she, I think I saw something a few months ago about, she'd be interested in AEW if they presented a contract to her after a WWE contract is over. Maybe that's what management caught wind of. I don't know. But Kairi Sane has sorely been underused on Monday Night Raw. And I feel for her. But it came across on TV that you'd rather be anywhere but there. And Roman Reigns has given off that vibe many times as well. But, Kairi Sane has just, man, I saw her and she was just going through the motions. She was just a zombie through the match. So she really detracted from the quality of the match because of how just disinterested she was, clearly. And I don't think that was by design of her being a heel. I think that's her as a person just being uninspired by, hey, I'm taking the pinfall. I haven't done much anyway. I'm just here to take the fall and give the belts to Alexa and Nikki. But outside of that...
And that's what I felt when she came out, when she threw down... Gosh, I wish I could remember if it was like her fan or her umbrella, whatever it was. When she threw it down on the entrance ramp, I was like... That was the first thing I was like, man, she does not look happy. And then that right after that, I was like, I wonder if they're going to drop the titles tonight. And then sure enough, and I was like, well, I'd be damned. Like, and then that's when I was like, you're just playing, like reading way too much into it. So, and then that's when I was like, I'll just be curious to see if anyone else noticed it. But man, I was just blown away by that.
It was very obvious, very obvious. And so, but as far as the outcome goes, makes total sense. I agree with Alexa and Nikki winning because, although I'm kind of scared at the same time, because it seems as if when the women's tag team wins the women's tag team championships, they just go into oblivion. And while the Kabuki Warriors started to get a little bit of momentum after they did what they did to Paige and then won the belts, we've seen it before with, the inaugural champions of Bayley and Sasha Banks. They just went into oblivion. We saw it with the Iconics, who went into nowhere. Now we saw it with the Kabuki Warriors on the back end of their run. It's like, oh yeah, they're champions. And now with Nikki and Alexa, hopefully this streak of going into the ether of just nowhere when the women win the belts changes with these two, because I think that they have a natural chemistry. Nikki can actually be obnoxious at times. I don't like her over-the-top, constant schoolgirl type of just overexertion of her excitement all the time. But I like the chemistry they have in a team that we all thought was going to end up with Alexa turning on Nikki, which still could, but it seems unlikely at this point. So hopefully with these two with holding the belts, we'll do something with the belts and be there on a weekly basis instead of just kind of playing, oh, it's your turn to have the belt and your turn to have the belt and your turn to have the belt. We're not going to do anything with you, but you can hold the belt. And that's what it seems like with the Women's Tag Team Championship. So, Ashley, what did you think about this?
Yeah, besides the whole entrance part, the match itself was fine. And I kind of hope that since they lost, this is kind of leading into maybe Asuka going back, maybe facing Becky again if they're not going to do anything with Shayna. That'll always be an option there. And then maybe this could be something good for Kairi Sane. Maybe she, in my opinion, she should go back to NXT because that's where she was best utilized at. And I just think right now, especially nowadays, she's just not going to get used right. Because what are they going to do? Go back and have a rematch for the tag team titles? And if they win, then what? I think that Kairi needs to go back to NXT and let Asuka do her thing on either SmackDown or Raw, depending on when they do the superstar shakeup or the draft or whatever it's going to be. But the match itself was fine. I just hope that they do something different now with both Asuka and Kairi going forward. But then it's like, what do you do with Alexa and Nikki? Who do they face? Where have the Iconics been? It's just like there's so many questions.
I miss them. I don't know.
I do too. Like they're for me, like they were like a guilty pleasure. I'm not gonna lie. They were entertaining to me. Billy Kay was very, very funny.
Well, if I may expound for a second, this is what I noticed about the match. One, like we said, I thought Kairi Sane was I jokingly said stoned earlier, but I mean, she just wasn't in it. Like the match was going on, but her mind was a million miles away. And that was really prevalent when she went up to the rope, top rope for the elbow, for the pinfall save. And the camera completely caught it. And you could see her posing. Like there was no, oh my gosh, moment, you know, it was just like, oh, well, she's already up there. Let's have that elbow. And it almost seemed like it was like a second late. Aside from that though, like the whole Bliss Cross situation, I think they can garner heat. I think they can, really like draw stuff in, but it's like, Ashley, you put it great. Who are they going to face? What's going to go, you know, what's going to happen now? Where is the competition? Because it's not built in that women's tag team division either show. It's just really not built, and it's not as hot as it could be.
Yeah, they need to explore NXT more, to your point, for the tag team aspect of it.
I hate to see her in the tag team, but I'd love to see Toni Storm come up. Let's do something with her. It's like it's out there in limbo right now. Bianca Belair, she's too big for NXT at this point. She doesn't need the NXT Women's Championship. It would look great around her waist, but there's so much more for her to start out in a tag team on the main roster and then build up to a SmackDown or Raw Women's Championship around her waist. I think that would be great. Remember, Becky Lynch did not hold the NXT title to my knowledge at all. So with that being said, you can always skip somebody and their prevalence could be on the main roster with more eyeballs on them. Bianca Belair could be that, but especially starting out in the tag team, I think that could be fun. With that being said, I love Nikki Cross. I love her insanity. I love everything she does. If this match had a detractor, it's Kairi Sane. I think to me, the highlight was Cross. Asuka still kind of playing to a crowd that's not there. I don't like that. And let's see what else I have in the notes here. There was a couple sloppy moments, and I could see the camera-to-camera editing, the cut from this side to this side to miss something, which, I don't know, it just – maybe people just didn't really care at that point, or maybe, like we said, Sane knew she was taking the pinfall, so she just really didn't care. But Basically, it was a Passover match. It was a C minus to me. So that's the way I kind of saw it, guys.
Yeah, I honestly, I don't know what more to say about this match. We covered it, you know, from every angle you probably could, and I just hope that the belts, to me, the championships are what needs to be focused on here, because for so long, WWE tried to create this movement that there was this, we need women's tag team championships. They actually tried to fake a grassroots movement by planting people in the crowd with signs that say, we want women's tag team championships. Like that was a thing. They actually planted people in the crowd to do that. And while people were saying, yeah, that'd be cool, there wasn't this massive movement of, oh my God, there's got to be women's tag team champions. I didn't hear it. People were interested, but not to the point of like a huge movement. It was all about just making sure the women are recognized on the show, that they have a proper placement, that they are given more time, and they got all of that. So now they bring in these tag team championships that from the start didn't have a whole lot of value to them. And since then, it's been a cursed championship with every team that's held it just going into nowhere and forgotten about, probably yes. Because the teams don't have anyone to face, and that it's not a focus of WWE because there's always bigger things going on with the women. So hopefully this changes. The championship to me is really the real victim here. And those are my final thoughts on that match. Did you guys, I mean, I honestly didn't watch a ton of the kickoff show as far as even the match went with Gulak and, Yeah. Gulak and Cesaro. I didn't really, I mean, I caught the finish of it, but does anybody have any comments on the kickoff match?
Go ahead.
From what I saw, I didn't catch the entire match, but Cesaro hit this one cool spot where he was spinning Gulak on his neck without holding on to him with his hands or anything. It was just his neck. So there's probably a GIF or something of it already out there, but that was pretty cool. So it's definitely a match, like if you have some downtime and you're curious, it's a fun match. If they're given more time, it could have been better, but it was a fun match.
It's basically last like 2 minutes is what I caught, and like what she was talking about, these guys had perfected these spots years ago and like Evolve and Pro Wrestling Rule and stuff like that, and I it just destroys me to see them shamed off to a pre-show. Because these guys have cut their chops, but yet we have somebody who's never set foot in the ring proper, like Rob Gronkowski, with his shades on, acting like, well, I'll censor myself. and this person gets, you know, a better payday because, you know, I think you understand where I'm going with this whole thing. But the fact is that it's strange to me how there was such a great pre-show match, even though I only caught a couple minutes of it. That was better than, I'd say, 50% of the matches that we were presented with last night. And we got to do with pre-shows, and we have to build more storylines. We have to build a lot more development, and we have to look towards the future. And that's the main things that we've talked about today, is the fact that where does Stroman go? Where do the tag belts go? Where's Corbin and Elias going? Is there a follow-up? Can we see this? And then the other side of it is, how much of this do we swallow without a crowd, with so many people playing to crowds that aren't there, with Nikki Cross clapping for the fan momentum in the tag match, and there's no fans to clap along? And hey, Gronk and Mojo didn't even care, so that's pretty bad. So
yeah,
go ahead, guys. I'm sorry, I was getting sidetracked.
No, that's okay. I'm. This whole thing is, you know, you always wonder if the crowd was there, that this was a normal WrestleMania, what the bookings would be and what the crowd reaction would be. And WWE has nothing to gauge how they're doing other than social media. And social media can be a cesspool. And you're really not gauging how the fans are reacting in real time other than what people are tweeting behind their thumbs. And that can be dangerous for storylines, or it could be a blessing, because WWE may just charge on with what they believe is best without that focus group, as they like to call it, every single night. So it's going to be interesting to see how long this virus pandemic goes on, which means how long that they could be doing these empty arena shows. And really, I'm very interested to see tonight. I mean, tonight is, I think, a bigger night on paper than last night even was. And I'm not going to do a full preview, but I do have to ask, what match are you looking forward to the most? And the last question is, do you see a John Cena heel turn tonight? So, Michael, go ahead first.
Edge and Orton. I want to see Edge and Orton. That story has been strung out. It has been played beautifully. I want to see something beautiful. I think that if there's anything that's going to be poetry in motion tonight, it's going to be that. It's going to be amazing. There's going to be a story told. There's going to be, I think, two professionals who, minus the poses coming into the ring, will ignore the fact that there's not people there. I think that they are going to put on a match, and they're going to put on a story, and they're going to tell a story, and they're just going to – you have two wrestling authors in a ring, and it is going to be amazing, especially for Edge. Knowing, you know, whatever happens, this could be his last WrestleMania. I believe that is going to be the cherry on top of the sundae. With that being said, a Cena heel turn, I wish, I hope, probably not, but I hope, I wish. And we have to remember that the Fiend's magical powers, if you get defeated, you revert to who you used to be. Well, I'd love to see a heel Dr. Thugonomics come back, because that's what he needs if he's going to be back. But the fact is, he's going back to Hollywood. So do we really care? If you're gone in Hollywood long enough, the people turn on you, just like they did The Rock.
Ashley?
Yeah. For me as well, it's Edge and Orton. Again, I'm just so heartbroken that I won't be there to actually see it. But at the same token, I'm just happy that Edge is in a situation where he's able to come back and have this moment. And of course, it's not how we all would like it to be, but I'm happy that he's even able to come back and have a match in and of itself. So I'm just very happy to see how this plays out. And just, it's kind of weird to say it's a feel good match because of the storyline and the intensity and probably the violence that we're going to see out of it. But I just think it's going to be a beautiful match. And I think it's going to probably steal the show. But I say that, and then I'm equally as excited to see how the Firefly Funhouse plays out as well, for completely different reasons. Just especially now seeing what they did with the Boneyard match. I am just, man, I'm so excited to see, because you have to know that Bray had a heavy hand in how this looks and how this plays out. So I'm just so excited to kind of get a glimpse to see. And of course, it's probably not 100% what he would do if he had full creative control over it, but even if we get like 30 or 40%, and maybe that's being generous, but even if we get something, some percentage of his input into how this looks and plays out, I think that has a high probability of being the, I guess, match of the night as well. So I think I'm equally as excited for both, but just for completely different reasons. But as far as the heel turn, again, like you said, Michael, I would love to see it. Maybe, like I said before, maybe the time is now. And he has time on his hands with everything in Hollywood being on pause and him living in Florida. And, hey, the shows are promo-heavy nowadays, and who better to cut a long and substantial promo than John Cena and have a strong story just on the mic go from week to week than a John Cena. So there's just so many things that they could do with it. And again, if he's into it and WWE is into it, then I would be 100% here for it. But I doubt we get it. But I think if it were ever to happen, this would probably be the time.
So I'll answer that question first that I posed to you guys. I think that there's the biggest chance that there's ever been to have John Cena turn heel tonight. Because of the fact that John Cena is not the future of WWE by any means. He's got way more matches behind him than in front of him. It's a safe time to do it because of the fact that he's not the future, so they don't have to worry about, well, is this a good decision or is it not? Well, you kind of are in a safe zone. It's playing with house money, because even if it ends up being a terrible decision, it's not going to really affect WWE on a day-to-day basis or TV week-to-week, because he's not going to be there week-to-week. It's just going, you could go, oh my God, what's he going to do next? He's turned heel. I think it would create a hell of a buzz for WWE, because people have been asking for it for 10, 15 years. So I think there's never been a safer time to do it, a better time to do it. And it's a possibility. I'd give it maybe like a 40%, 30-40% chance of it happening. So I'm not going to expect it, but I would certainly say that it's the highest probability we've seen. As far as the matches go, I think that, I'm going to side with you guys on the storyline of what I'm looking forward to the most, and Edge and Orton by a long shot. And Edge's promo Monday night was one of the best promos I've seen in months, maybe even years. Just how damn good he was sitting in the back, and his cadence, the way he spoke, the realism he had, the truth that he spoke about Randy Orton, how he's never really reached his full potential, and that they only see him at his best when he's around. And that's damn true. I mean, that's true. We've all seen the uninspired Randy Orton that he's been for how many years, and when he's even okay, he's better than most. And that's, we've said that too. So this is going to be a match from a storyline perspective I'm the most emotionally invested in, and it could easily steal the show. So any final thoughts on, I'll start with Ashley first. Any final thoughts on WrestleMania tonight or any other topic that we didn't discuss?
No, I think for what they had to work with, they did a pretty good job. I was pleased with the show, and it left me looking forward to tonight, like I mentioned earlier. And I think that's pretty much all they could ask for at this point. And I was kind of curious to see the general feedback, so I was kind of checking out Twitter earlier, and WWE actually did a poll, looks like last night, asking what was your favorite match from night one. And they had Undertaker, AJ Styles, Stroman and Goldberg, Owens and Rollins, and Lynch and Baszler. And Undertaker and Styles won with 77%, and it's about 123,000 votes in and some change. So if that tells you anything, that's pretty interesting. And Owens and Rollins was second with 12%. So it's pretty interesting to see that the vast majority really enjoyed that match. So that leaves me hopeful for the response for the Firefly Funhouse tonight. But also in the same token, really quick, it's kind of interesting to me to see all the positivity for this, but then all the backlash for, like, the ultimate deletion. So that's just kind of curious to me. What are your guys' quick thoughts on that?
Well, you know, when I watched, like, the ultimate deletions back and forth over and over again, it was entertaining, it was funny, it was goofy. I actually called friends over to watch it, even if they weren't wrestling fans, because they thought it was hilarious how, like, you know, you have all this tag team wrestling going on, and then all of a sudden the doorbell rings and it gets answered, and it's the Express that knocks and rolls. No, it was. Sorry, guys, I can do them pretty well. Honestly, I'm glad you asked this question, because it bleeds into the thing that I want to ask you both, which with this Firefly Funhouse, I do see. I'm thinking Jeff Hardy make an appearance in this because of the tag situation between Bray Wyatt before and Matt Hardy, and the fact that they're not doing anything with him, and the fact that they could bring him into prevalence. But if you're going to beat Cena, you're going to have to bring out all the guns. And if he wasn't part of the Edge and Morton scene, I think that he has to be part of this, or I can just see him reacclimated if he's, you know, free of all legal issues, if you know what I mean. But, you know, hooking us all aside, I think the best to answer the whole question before, the best match on the card was Owens and Rollins. Matt?
Oh, sorry. My mic was off. Yeah, I mean, this, to me, like, I'm looking at this whole WrestleMania as under the lens that this is not your normal WrestleMania, clearly. And to put this against any other WrestleMania, I think, is not fair. This can't be compared against really anything. It has no way to be compared to any other show that WWE has done on a pay-per-view basis. And so I think that people need to understand that. And when you're looking at the poll you said, Ashley, about people loving the AJ Styles and Undertaker match the most, I understand why. I get it. It makes sense. I see why they do, because it may have been, quote, the most entertaining for the purposes of a thematic or cinematic type of presentation. So a lot of people like that because it was well done for what it was supposed to be. But again, you can't look at it from a pro wrestling perspective per se, even though they did have, quote, wrestling moves in there. So, I mean, I don't know. To me, part two is something I'm really looking forward to because of now I know what to expect. I know the environment. I know how it's going to feel, especially, as you said, Ashley, the Firefly Funhouse is – I'm looking forward to that more than I normally would have. So I don't know. I guess my final thoughts on this whole thing is right now I'd give the part one a B. As far as if I was going to grade it A to F, I'd give it a B. There were certainly some down points, but certainly points that you'd go, okay, this is for the situation they're in, this isn't bad. So those are my final thoughts on the whole part one. And it's, I don't know, I'm looking forward to part two. And I, you know, both Michael and Ashley will have to have a conversation at some point for part two, because this is going to be a night that I'm sure will be left going, wait, what? And just based on what Vince McMahon likes to do at the end of WrestleMania, is there's always something big that happens, whether it's, you know, Undertaker's streak or when Stone Cold turned heel, or there's always something big that Vince likes to do. And I don't think tonight's going to be any different.
I smell something happening. I don't know what. I don't know what can make that impact, but I definitely feel that there's something that it's definitely going to happen, because this is such an odd situation. This isn't an anomaly. So I feel that Vince is going to throw something in there, and I just don't know what it is yet. But if you guys have any ideas, you let me know. Aside from that, Ashley?
Yeah, I'm right there with you guys. I'm stoked for part two. And I'm just really excited to see how this all plays out. And yeah, we'll definitely have to reconvene and maybe go over part two at some point.
Awesome. Well, before we head out, let everyone know, both of you guys, I'll start with Michael first, any social media or shout outs that you guys want to do at this time?
You can always find me at 144Captain on Twitter. Every time we do a broadcast, which I love, and I'm always humbled by being on the show, by the way, I always get new followers and new people giving me questions and wanting to pick my brain, which I think is great, because I kind of feel like out of our organization, I'm kind of like the Mike Tenay. But I'm the old man. But, you know, aside from that, I have had a blast. I'm so happy that I finally got to talk to Ashley in person with you. And I don't really have any shout outs except for my boy Josh Bear. He's a faithful listener, and my boy John Belko. They're great guys. They're faithful listeners. Of course, DJ Kuzmo, because he loves us. And I just want to segue over to Ash and tell you guys, thank you. I love you guys. Thank you.
Well, yeah, I could not say it better myself. I second that, Michael. It was great and to finally actually speak with you as well. And Matt, it's always a pleasure. And yeah, looking forward to part two. Feel free to follow me on Twitter at @ashmanns. I'm trying to get better at the whole Twitter thing. But yeah, looking forward to part two, and hopefully we can all get together and talk about it.
Definitely. This is going to be a week where I don't know if I'm going to have a day off of not sitting in front of my microphone, to my wife's dismay. I really, as I'm sure she right now is like, when are you going to be done with that damn thing? But it's WrestleMania time, so I kind of get a pass on that. I tell her, she's like, well, she kind of understands what WrestleMania is. I'm like, hey, it's a Super Bowl of wrestling, you know? And she's like, oh, okay. Like, you know, but after this
so
week.
So I'm sure she loves probably the two-night format.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, she's like, wait, it's two nights? She's like, I thought it was only one. I'm like, no. I'm like, it's too big for one night. I'm like, I can't do it in one
night.
Right,
right. Try to explain that to her.
yeah. So, all right, guys. Well, thanks so much for being on, and we will definitely be in touch. Stay
Sounds
safe.
Good. You too. Thank Take you. Care.
Goodbye. Bye.
Thanks for listening to the WWE Podcast. Don't forget to subscribe on your favorite podcast app so you don't miss a show, or head to WWEPodcast.com. And for all of these shows ad-free, head over to Patreon.com/WWE Podcast. Until then, we'll see you next time.